Got a new shirt. I like it. So, Little Prince, carrying on. The proof that the Little Prince existed is that he was charming. That he laughed. That he was looking for a sheep. If anybody wants a sheep, that's a proof that the Little Prince exists. And what good would it do to tell them that? They would just shrug their shoulders and treat you like a child. But if you said to them, the planet that he came from is asteroid B612, then they would be convinced and they would leave you in peace from their questions. They're like that. One must not hold against them. Children should always show great forbearance towards grown-up people. But certainly for us who understand life, figures are a matter of indifference. I should have liked to begin the story in the fashion of the fairy tales. I should have liked to say, once upon a time, there was a little prince who lived on a planet that was scarcely any bigger than himself, and who had the need of his sheep. But to those who understand life, that would have given... To those who understand life, that would have given a much greater air of truth to my stories. For I do not want anyone to read my book carelessly. I have suffered too much grief in setting down these memories. 6 years have already passed since my friend went away from me with his sheep. If I try to describe him here, it is to make sure that I shall not forget him. To forget a friend is sad. Not everyone has had a friend. And if I forget him, I may become like the grown-ups who are no longer interested in anything but figures. It is for that purpose, again, that I have brought a box of paints and some pencils. It is hard to take up drawing again at my age, when I have never made any drawings except those of boa constrictors from the outside and boa constrictors from the inside since I was 6. I shall certainly try to make my portraits as true to life as possible, but I am not at all sure of success. One drawing goes along all right, another has no resemblance to the subject. I make some errors too in the little prince's height. In one place he's too tall, in another he's too short. And I feel some doubts about the color of his costume. So I fumble along as best as I can, now good, now bad, and I hope generally fair to middling. In certain more important details, I shall make mistakes also, but that is something that would not be my fault. My friend never explained anything to me. He thought, perhaps, that I was like himself. But I, alas, do not know how to see sheep through the walls of boxes. Perhaps I am a little like the grown-ups. I have had to grow old. As each day passed, I would learn in our talk something about the little prince's planet. His departure from it, his journey, the information would come very slowly as it might chance to fall from his thoughts. It was in this way that I had heard on the third day about the catastrophe of the baobabs. This time, once more, I had the sheep to thank for it. The little prince asked me abruptly, as if seized by a grave doubt, "It is true, isn't it, that sheep eat little bushes?" "Yes, that is true. Ah, I am glad." I did not understand why it was so important that sheep should eat little bushes. But then the little prince added, "Then it follows that they also eat baobabs." I pointed out to the little prince that baobabs were not little bushes, but on the contrary, trees as big as castles. And that even if he took a whole herd of elephants away from him, the herd would not eat up one single baobab. The idea of a herd of elephants made the little prince laugh. "We would have to put them one on top of the other," he said. But he made a wise comment. "Before they grow so big, the baobabs start out by being little." Got a picture of the elephants. Herd of elephants on his asteroid B612. So before they grow so big, the baobabs start out by being little. "That's correct," I said, "but why do you want the sheep to eat the little baobabs?" He answered me at once, "Oh, come, as if he were speaking of something that was self-evident. And I was obliged to make a great mental effort to solve this problem without any assistance. Indeed, as I learned, there were on the planet where the little prince lived, as on all planets, good plants and bad plants. In consequence, there were good seeds from good plants and bad seeds from bad plants. but seeds are invisible. They sleep down the heart of the earth's darkness until someone among them is seized with a desire to awaken. Then this little seed will stretch itself and begin, timidly at first, to push a charming little sprig inoffensively upward toward the sun. If it is only a sprout of radish or the sprig of a rose bush, one would let it grow wherever it may wish. But when it was a bad plant, one must destroy it as soon as possible, the very first instant that one recognizes it. Now there were some terrible seeds on the planet that was the home of the little prince, and these were the seeds of the baobab. The soil of the planet was infested with them. A baobab is something you will never, never be able to get rid of if you attend it too late. It spreads over the entire planet. It bores clear through it with its roots. And if the planet is too small, and the baobabs are too many, they split it into pieces. It's a question of discipline, the little prince said to me later on. When you finished your own toilet in the morning, it is time to attend to the toilet of your planet, just so with the greatest care. You must see to it that you pull up regularly all the baobabs at the very first moment when they can be distinguished from the rose bushes, which they resemble so closely in their earliest youth. It is very tedious work, the little prince added, but very easy. One day he said to me, you ought to make a beautiful drawing so that the children where you live can see exactly how all this is. That would be very useful to them if they were to travel someday. Sometimes, he added, there is no harm in putting off a piece of work until another day. But when it is a matter of baobabs, that always means a catastrophe. I knew a planet that was inhabited by a lazy man, and he neglected three little bushes. So as the little prince described it to me, I have made a drawing of that planet. I do not much like to take the tone of a moralist, but the danger of the baobabs is so little understood, and such considerable risk would be run by anyone who might get lost on an asteroid, that for once I am breaking through my reserve. Children, I say plainly, watch out for the baobabs. My friends, like myself, have been skirting this danger for a long time without ever knowing it, and so it is for them that I've worked so hard over this drawing. The lesson which I pass on by this means is worth all the trouble it has cost me. Perhaps you will ask me, why are there no other drawings in this book as magnificent and impressive as this drawing of the baobabs? The reply is simple. I have tried, but with the others, I have not been successful. When I made the drawing of the baobabs, I was carried beyond myself by the inspiring force of urgent necessity. The baobabs taking over the whole planet. 6. Oh, little prince, bit by bit I came to understand the secrets of your sad little life. For a long time you have found your only entertainment in the quiet pleasure of looking at the sunset. I learned that new detail on the morning of the fourth day when you said to me, I am very fond of sunsets. Come, let us go look at a sunset now. But we must wait, I said. Wait? For what? For the sunset, we must wait until it is time. At first you seemed to be very much surprised, and then you laughed to yourself, and you said to me, I am always thinking that I am at home. Just so everybody knows that when it is noon in the United States, the sun is setting over France. If you could fly to France in 1 minute, you could go straight into the sunset, right from noon. Unfortunately, France is too far away for that. But on your tiny planet, my little prince, all you need to do is move your chair a few steps. Then you can see the day end and the twilight falling whenever you like. One day you said to me, I saw the sunset 44 times. And a little later you added, you know, one loves the sunset when one is so sad. Were you so sad then, I asked, on the day of the 44 sunsets? But the little prince made no reply. Seven. On the fifth day, again, as always, it was thanks to the sheep, the secret of the little prince's life was revealed to me. Abruptly, without anything to lead up to it, and as if the question had been born of long and silent meditation on his problem, he demanded, a sheep, if it eats little bushes, does it eat flowers too? A sheep, I answered, eats anything it finds in its reach. Even flowers that have thorns? Yes, even flowers that have thorns. Then the thorns, what use are they? I did not know. At that moment, I was very busy trying to unscrew a bolt which had got stuck in my engine. I was very much worried, for it becoming clear to me that the breakdown of my plane was extremely serious. So I had so little drinking water left that I had to fear the worst. The thorns, what use are they? The little prince never let go of a question once he had asked it. As for me, I was upset over that bolt, and I answered with the first thing that came into my head. The thorns are of no use at all. Flowers have thorns just for spite. Oh! There was a moment of complete silence. Then the little prince flashed back at me with a kind of resentfulness. I don't believe you. Flowers are weak creatures. They are naive. They reassure themselves as best as they can. They believe that their thorns are terrible weapons. I did not answer. At that instant, I was saying to myself, if this bolt still won't turn, I'm going to knock it out with a hammer. Again, the little prince disturbed my thoughts. And you actually believe that they're flowers? Oh, no, I cried. No, 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 I don't believe anything. I answered you with the first thing that came to my head. Don't you see, I am busy with matters of consequence. He stared at me, thunderstruck. Matters of consequence? He looked at me there with my hammer in my hand, my fingers back. Black with engine grease, bending down over an object which seemed to him extremely ugly. You talk just like the grown-ups. That made me a little ashamed. But he went on relentlessly. You mix everything up together. You confuse everything. He was really angry. He tossed his golden curls in the breeze. I know a planet where there is a certain red-faced gentleman, and he never smelled a flower. He has never looked at a star. He has never loved anyone. He has never done anything in his life but add up figures. All day he says over and over, just like you, I am busy with matters of consequence. And that makes him swell up with pride. But he is not a man. He's a mushroom. A what? A mushroom. The little prince was now white with rage. The flowers have been growing thorns for millions of years. For millions of years the sheep have been eating them just the same. And is it not a matter of consequence to try to understand why the flowers go on so much trouble to grow thorns which are of never any use to them? Is the warfare between the sheep and the flowers not important? Is this not of more consequence than a fat, red-faced gentleman's sums? And if I know, I myself, one flower which is unique in all the world which grows nowhere but on my planet, but which one little sheep can destroy in a single bite some morning without even noticing what he is doing. Oh, and you think that that is not important? His face turned from white to red as he continued. If someone loves a flower of which just one single blossom grows in all the millions and millions of stars, it is enough to make him happy to look at the stars. He can say to himself somewhere, my flower is up there. But if the sheep eats the flower, at one moment, all his stars will be darkened. And you think that is not important. I like that line. I'm going to repeat it. If someone loves a flower, of which just one single blossom grows in all the millions and millions of stars, it is enough to make him happy just to look at the stars. And he could say to himself somewhere, my flower is there. But if the sheep eats the flower, at one moment, all the stars will be darkened. And you think that is not important. He could not say anything more. His words were choked by sobbing. The night had fallen. I let my tools drop from my hands. Of what moment now was my hammer, my bolt, or thirst, or death? On one star, one planet, my planet, the Earth, there is a little prince to be comforted. And I took him in my arms and I rocked him and I said to him, the flower that you love is not in danger. I will draw you a muzzle for your sheep. I will draw you a railing to put around your flower. I did not know what to say to him. I felt awkward and blundering. I did not know how I could reach him, where I could overtake him and go hand in hand with him once more. It is such a secret place, the land of tears.